my Dhamma brothers and sisters, friends. Today I would like to talk about a very, very important topic about freedom from non-clinging to views. So Buddha's teaching on right views and decision making. You see, the world is full of views. Historically, when the Buddha came to the scene, there are already 62 views. Can you imagine? 62 views. And that's 2,600 years ago. 62 views. These views are many. I cannot explain them, all of them here. One of them is like jhanas, when you attain deep concentration, is the enlightenment state. Second jhana, first jhana, second jhana. Indulging in sensual pleasure is a part of nibbana. Well, welcome to nibbana. I think indulging in sensual pleasures is part of an experience of attaining bananas. In Uganda, we eat a lot of bananas. Yes, so the more you like bananas, the more you get bananas, of course. So, many of you 62, but when the Buddha came to teach the Dhamma, he didn't expect that his teaching is going to be part of the views. So he didn't expect to be the 63rd. So even the Buddha didn't expect his teaching to be the 63rd, but still people make it a view. The Dhamma is the Dhamma, is the way how things are. So talking about views, recently I went to in a school called Field South Primary School to teach meditation. I was so impressed how many views kids had when I asked them, would you put a big kangaroo in a fridge? Where is Loza? She's here? Okay, what do you do? My friend there. Yes. No, cannot talk. Okay, I can't start with anybody. How would you put a big kangaroo in a fridge? Anybody can tell me the answer. It's about views. There's nothing mystery about it. So, we start with you. Anybody? Popcorn style. Anybody can tell me, how do you put a big kangaroo in a fridge? I think you have listened to my talk before. Another person? That's one of you. Okay, another one. Okay, another one. No views? There we go. One of the kids actually gave me that answer. The answer is very simple. Open the door and put it there. Very simple. Open the refrigerator door and put it there. But we have the view that the refrigerator has to be big. we have a view that the kangaroo is, I'm going to put it there for hours. I just want to put it maybe 1 second. So the steps are very simple. Open the door and put it there. Why would you cut it? One kid actually told me, one kid had a different view. She said, why would you like to put a kangaroo in a fridge? That's another view. So we have so many views, and views have no problem, but that's when we cling on to them. That's when it becomes a problem. I tell you what happened in the monastery, not all monasteries, but the monastery where I practiced, I trained as a monk, is in West Virginia. And the abbot is Bhante Gunaratana, Henepala Gunaratana from Sri Lanka. Venerable Gunaratana was not in the monastery. He had gone somewhere. So we are around 4 monks, and there were some lay people around. In the morning, we go meditate at around 4:30, we got to meditate in the morning, and then we had chanting. Now there was a rule that before we leave the meditation hall, we have to douse the candle. We have to douse that candle. We shouldn't leave the meditation hall without dousing the candle. And sometimes we rotate it, another monk will douse it, another one will douse it. One wonderful day came where one monk, I remember very well, he went and held the candle like this and blew it like this. That was the end of the world. One monk started saying, no, you shouldn't do that in case saliva goes out of your mouth. It will be not very good for the audience. Eh? You know when you like the... like saliva can come and just kind of a spill around, you know. Then another monk said, actually another monk came and said, you know, you don't have to use your air. Save your air to cool the porridge. So what you have to do is actually to get that stick. And this is it. And you see, he even demonstrated. And so you lower it down like this and put it there like this. And according to him, if you disturb oxygen, fire will go. That is another view. Meantime, the one who blowing at, I said, no, that, no problem. Then another monk, who was the vice abbot, told us that actually the best way to douse the candle is actually to put it inside there. And then you actually touch the fire and then stop it. Stop the fire by just touching the fire like that. I was there myself. I said, I don't care. Who cares? That's another view. Who cares? There was another layman there, seeing all the three monks having different views. Actually, four monks, because for me, that's another view. And the lay person was there and say, you see, when you douse a candle, you have to do it with mindfulness. Lift this with mindfulness, stretch with mindfulness, lower it down with mindfulness, and pull it down, and the candle goes out. Four views. Five. Actually, from my experience, we can have as many views as many people. So how many are we? Maybe 100? No? 50? We have 50 views, I think. We all come from different place. So different views. So now, this is a very, very important topic because attachment to views have caused many wars. Some of them religious views, personal views. Leave alone wars that have been fought historically, but relationships. How many relationships have ended because of different views? I want my coffee with a little bit of milk. Eh? You see, you come and see how many views we have there when you give us food, especially breakfast. I like chamomile tea. Don't put milk, don't put sugar, don't put anything. That's my view. And it works for me. It's not going to work for another monk. Give me a third of milk, give me coffee, then another monk will come. I want to take hot water. Another monk. So different view. But the key is not to have views at all. The key is holding on to your views, and if people are contributing other views, then you don't accept them. So the idea was clinging on. The Buddha's idea was not to cling tenaciously on their views because they cause suffering. That was the whole idea, that views can lead to suffering. But not only views, actually clinging on to anything. Clinging on to anything brings a lot of suffering. You know the difference between clinging and craving? Buddha Gosa gave a good example. Like craving is like a thief trying to reach something but they haven't got it. Right? That's craving. And clinging is when actually somebody has got something, the thief has got it, and then he's holding on it. So like this, like probably this would be like this. If this is like a stick, and this in my hand here, that would be craving for the stick. But clinging, I got it, and then I hold it like this. In case you're wondering what's the difference between desire and craving and clinging, that's the difference. Holding on to it. You have the view and hold on to it, and you don't want to let go. Right? Whether you want your cup to be left placed on the right side or left side, whether you want your husband to wear a suit or not, whether you want to come to a BSV to attend a Dhamma talk, or go to watch a movie. All those are different views at a different time, and it can actually bring a lot of suffering if somebody doesn't want to let go their views. That's a big problem. But we have seen this happening even 2,600 years ago. One time there's a discourse, that's why I brought the Tipitaka. Usually I don't bring actually these books. I don't want to be called a Tipitaka thumper. You know, Bible thumper? Tipitaka thumper. So usually I will put things in the head and just talk about things. But I was inspired to bring this book because we found out 7 enlightened beings had different views. We are talking about people who are enlightened. What about us who are not yet enlightened? Or half enlightened? Or half full enlightened? Okay. So this discourse is amazing. In case you are wondering why people have different views and why they have different views and how we suffer and how we can accept others' views, we have to read a discourse which is called Mahagosinga Sutta. Sutta is number 32. Sutta number 32 is very interesting, how even enlightened beings have different views. I'll just summarize it here. There are 7 monks. One is called Ananda, Venerable Sariputta, Rewata, Venerable Anuruddha, Venerable Kassapa, and Venerable Moggallana, and then Sariputta, and finally the Buddha, Buddhamdru. How many are they? 7. Now the question came, in this discourse, the question came, and who's going to illuminate Gosinga Sala tree wood? That was a question was asked. So now Ananda, inside a person who's well learned, who knows all the discourses, is the one who's going to illuminate the wood, the forest. And then again, Venerable Sariputta, the one who's, Venerable Rewata, say a bhikkhu who delights in solitary meditation is the one who's going to enlighten the forest. That's the second monk. The third monk said, the monk who dwells in empty heart, a monastic, it doesn't matter, nun or monk, any person. So the one who dwells in empty heart and the one who has divine eye, because he was known for supernatural power. The one who has divine eye, who can survey the entire world, thousand world system. So divine eye is actually more than our normal eye. So that was his answer. Venerable Kassapa said, one who's secluded, loves seclusion, virtue, aloofness from society, energy, concentration, wisdom, deliverance, knowledge and wisdom, and somebody who praises all those virtues. Now, Moggallana said, the one who engaged in a talk in Abhidhamma, high Dhamma. So then yet the sixth monk, Sariputta, said, the one who wielded mastery over his mind or her mind, so one does not let the mind overcome him or her. So somebody, in other words, who is the master of the mind. So how many are they? There are 6 already, all of them enlightened, and they are giving their answers. Now, Venerable Sariputta was confused and went to the Buddha and said, which of us has spoken well? Which of us has spoken well? So now, this is where it's very interesting, because whenever we have views, we want to see whether ours is well spoken or the right one or the correct one. Now, Buddha, this is what he said. You have all spoken well, each of you in your own way. So you can see people actually might have different views, but all because they are speaking from their own inspiration, from their own training, from their worldview, you know. So when the bhikkhu had returned from arms, this is the Buddha's answer. He said like this, hear from me also. All bhikkhus are hearing now. When a bhikkhu, an ordained person, has returned from arms round after his or her meal, sits down, folds legs, cross-legged, and then mindfulness is established in front of that person, and then resolves, I shall not break my sitting position until non-clinging is attained, until you don't cling on to everything in the world, and then your mind is free from all taints. So you can see the Buddha also giving another answer. So what's going on here? Because all of them are enlightened beings. So the answer is very clear that Buddha said that all people are speaking from their own training, from their teachers. So no wonder sometimes you see around four monks coming and giving a talk and say, no, maybe there's contradiction. But these monks also are giving from their own training. So the key is to accept views and don't hold on to your views. I think that's a message. All right, when the Buddha came, found these views going around the world, so what he did is to teach a teaching that critically respond to those beliefs and get out of those paradigm, get out of those extremes. One extreme was self-indulgence and self-mortification. What people were clinging on to self-indulgence of senses. Others were saying, okay, let us starve ourselves to death. So the Buddha decided to teach the Noble Eightfold Path. In case you want to let go of your views, not cling on to views, the entire Noble Eightfold Path is there for us to let go. Because it's a middle path, it's a middle way that actually avoid all those views of self-mortification and self-indulgence. Yet another view that usually is common in our life, to say that there's no teaching on karma. One view is nothing is caused by karma. That's one view. Another one is everything is caused by karma. That's also another view. You see, the problem is the problem. Most people think that everything good is caused by God. And when things go wrong, they blame Buddhism. No karma. Big problem. We are in trouble. Everything going on wrong, oh yeah, it's my karma, it's their karma. Let them get on with their karma, you know. Yes. Everything happening in our life, the Buddha's teaching on karma is to stay out of those extremes, to allow a few things to be influenced by karma, and other things are not influenced by karma. One of them is a tsunami, earthquake, utuniyama, climate factors have nothing to do with the karma. The change in weather, okay, Melbourne is very cold, oh, we have bad karma. Okay, you know, you see, I go for a walk, you know, I'm an African monk, you know, it's very cold here, you know. Well, yeah, I came here, I have a bad karma, actually. Yesterday we went to walk. Usually we time the good weather, but yesterday we went to this park near, it's called Churchill Park. Next to Churchill Park, there's a Lesfield Park. It was cold. I told Matea, I said, you know, the key here to overcome this cold is just keep on walking. It was so cold, actually. But most people can say that they have bad karma. I've seen this happening, you know. So that has nothing to do with karma. Then there's another thing which has nothing to do with karma. If you plant beans, you'll get beans. If you plant beans, you will get beans. You're not going to get apples. That has nothing to do with karma. But people again blame karma, the law of karma, you know. What about rain? If you have, you receive a lot of rain, rain, or there's no rain. In Uganda, when there's no rain, the Uganda is a Christian country, and I was born a Christian, and this is exactly what's going on. Even people have studied biology, and they know how rain is formed. When it rains, people who have gone through schools and even have their degrees from the university, when it rains in Uganda, thank God. There's a lot of rain. When people die in Uganda, I don't know about in Australia, we have news all over the country announcing this person died. For me, it's so interesting to listen to this news. I don't know whether in Sri Lanka you have such news. Maybe Uganda is a crazy country. Every time, every day you'll get news who died in each corner of the world. I mean, in each corner of the country. But of course they have to pay. Those who cannot afford, they cannot take the announcement. I wonder why people do that, actually. I wonder why people make this announcement. It used to be the case that people didn't have telephones. And they have to use a lot of radio. But even now they have telephones, still those news are going on. But what's going on there is very interesting. When they say somebody died, oh, thank God, they call him to rest. Wow, what a denial. What a view. God is so busy, actually. How can he call people in Uganda and Sri Lanka and USA? Yeah. So now they have, I think their view. That's their view. I think I have to also let go my view. Yes. So anyway, these are the views that we have, and eternity, that people are going to stay forever in eternal bliss. And then also there's a view of annihilation, that people are at death, people are annihilated. That's materialism. Materialism is a view that thinks that whenever you die, everything stops from there. Earth goes to earth, water goes to water, and all these things. So that's another view. But the Buddha again taught the Noble Eightfold Path, right understanding, right thought, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right... you know the Noble Eightfold Path very well. I don't have to repeat it. So actually, when you practice like this, we can actually go out of those views, because we see, especially right mindfulness, we see for ourselves that things are rising. In meditation, we see that things are rising. So things cannot stop. If in meditation you see that things are rising, how do you have a view that things are going to stop all of a sudden when you die? And also things are ceasing. In meditation, we see things ceasing. Emotion ceasing, feeling ceasing, everything disappearing. So how are we going to have a view that, okay, things are going to exist forever? You see how actually meditation can help us to overcome the views? Because we see it from moment to moment. Okay, breathe in now and breathe out. We see it from that moment that the breath arises and the breath ceases when we pay mindfulness to it. Now, how are we going to have a view about that things are going to continue forever? If things are going to continue forever, the breath also will continue forever. Do you understand what I'm saying? That we see it from moment to moment in our practice of the Noble Eightfold Path. Right? So if the breath ceases, you see the breath arising and ceasing, that means that also when we pass away, right? We don't die, we just pass away, or pass on. So so what will happen? Are we going to cease or are we going to continue forever? That's the answer for you. And try to find an answer. Because you sit in meditation from moment to moment. The Buddha taught the Noble Eightfold Path. Specifically when you practice right mindfulness and you see things rising from moment to moment, impermanence nature of things, and then things rising and passing away, both rising and passing away, you are going to give up the view that is eternity view and also annihilation view. You have to give it up because you see it happening all the time. The breath is not annihilated, and the breath doesn't exist forever. So it's rising and passing away all the time. All right, I also want to keep a right view, practice right understanding, right view of the Noble Eightfold Path, which means also the Noble Eightfold Path, and the Four Noble Truths, the Noble Eightfold Path, understanding the law of karma, then you are going to go into what we call right view. Let's go to making a decision. Making a decision and right view is very connected, actually. When you have a certain view, you are going to base your decision on depending on what view you have. I remember one time I was in the United States as a layman. I visited a friend of mine, and he wanted to buy a towel for me because I was a visitor. Then he told me that he's going to buy a black towel. I said, no, don't buy a black towel for me. He told me, no, it's very good to have a black towel. Even if it gets dirty, you don't know. You don't have to wash it all the time. Another view coming in. Can you imagine? Actually, I've been to places where they have black towels and brown towels. First, I smell it. Because that's the only way to know. How are you going to know? Now, if he becomes the president of the country, or even becomes a principal of the school, boarding school, you're going to find black towels all over. That's going to determine the expenditure on towels. And now, for me, I told him, I would like to get me a white towel. He didn't believe it. Because this guy was almost 50 years from Guinea, West Africa. He didn't believe in a world there's somebody who uses a white towel. What are you doing with a white towel? I told him, you know, when I use a white towel, whenever it gets dirty, I'm going to see it right away. And I'm going to wash it just in time before it smells. Two views right there. Now, we are going to see also another view. Some people don't want to meditate. Some people don't want to meditate because meditation is like a white towel. It shows you exactly what's going on. Other people, they would rather stay in denial and not meditate and come for meditation because meditation shows them what is there. That's what we call right mindfulness. Mindfulness is like a mirror. It shows you what's going on. You see a mirror? When you go to a mirror, when you face the mirror like this, it doesn't say, oh, today you are ugly. Today you are beautiful. No, that's not the mirror's business. The mirror shows what's going on. But many people don't want to know what's going on. I remember a couple of years ago, I was giving a talk in USA, a 6 weeks retreat, and I happened to leave a little bit early, and I gave a talk on anger, how to overcome anger management, to put it in a modern term. So when I left, I heard that some people didn't like this talk. Because when I was giving a talk, people got even more angry. Can you imagine getting angry about listening to a talk about anger? Now, that's another view. What's very interesting also, the person said that actually, I never knew that I have anger. That's what they said. So my talk brought anger in him. Can you imagine? People have a view that even when I'm talking about anger, they will start to get angry. Because they have never seen all their life anger, and I'm talking about anger, and now I've planted anger in them. A very strange world. We are living in a strange world. Instead of saying, Bhante, thank you very much. You showed me anger. Like that white towel, it shows a lot of dirt. Thank you very much. I can see it. Now I can start sweeping it. I can start the job. My work has started today. Thank you very much, Bhante. I'm eternally grateful for you. But that's what I got. People started getting angry because after my talk, they start seeing anger. All moments in their life, they started to be very clear. Views, attached to views, bring decision making whether you are going to meditate or not. In fact, the view we have about the Noble Eightfold Path and the Noble Truth, whatever view we have about the word suffering, depends how we are going to do the practice. If we don't know it, we are going to ignore it. Right? So to the extent, to the degree and extent we understand the word suffering, then also to the degree and extent we are going to apply the methods to overcome it. That's very simple. So now how to make decisions in life. I think the whole life is full of decisions, isn't it? Decision to marry. Tough decision, eh? Especially when you don't pre-test. It's a big decision. Test marriage? You do test marriage here? No? It's not happening in the world? Sorry, I'm a little bit ignorant about this. So this is a big decision because it's going to change your life completely. Decision of a job. Decision to study psychology or mathematics or banking, engineering and all that. You spend 4 years, you are done. You're going to be an engineer. So then decision to travel. I had to make a decision to come back to Australia. It's a decision. Without decision making, you cannot proceed. Decision to have children. Decision to do this and that. Decision which food you are going to eat. So our world depends upon decision also. First, on views we have, and then decision we make. And decision we make can make change the course of our life. But how do we make decisions? How can we make sure that our decisions are right or wrong? This is a big problem. But the good news, the Buddha gave us a template that I'm going to share with you. There are three ways of making decisions. But maybe I should write them. How do we operate this? Another view. So I would like to write this to help people to make decisions clearly. Okay, figure it out and as I'm talking. Okay, now decision making. In Buddha's teaching, we have what we call the what's wholesome and unwholesome. Mm-hmm. Can you write fast and see what you're doing? Okay, please. So there. Okay, good. Thank you very much. Okay, decision making. If you want to make good decision, informed decision, right? First is about consequential principle. Please excuse me, my consequences. This is a consequence. So consequential principle. Principle. Alright? Principle. That you have to follow principles, alright? Principle. Sorry about my writing, okay? Yeah. Okay. So this is a principle. Principle. Alright? My handwriting is terrible. Hope that's not to your view. Okay. In other words, what are the results? When you are making your decision, what are the results? Look, it's kind of a short excursion into the results of your decision. Whatever decision have a result. So you have to take an excursion into your. So we have two possibilities here, right? Two possibilities here on one side and on another side. All right. So what are the consequences of the decision you're making? Is it going to lead to one's happiness? One's happiness? Or one's suffering? So that one you have to decide, right? You have to decide whether the decision you are making are going to lead to your happiness or your own suffering. So now that's one thing. Now, second, others' happiness. You have to consider that point. If you don't consider others, that's the problem. Because most people make a decision, they are happy, but others are not happy. Isn't it? Let's say you are in your family and you make a decision, one of your spouses make a decision to travel to Uganda. And she'd rather be in New Zealand. But you say, yeah, I'm the boss. Let's go to Uganda. And you end up being miserable. So then also others suffering. You have to consider if this is going to lead that one. Another one, both. Both. The combination of this one and this one. Both ones and others. And others. Happiness. So on one side you have happiness. Also, this is both. It has to be the combination. So this helps to know both means both oneself and others, right? So those are three ways we can do, three ways. So now the combination is also very important. The combination of oneself and others is very important because it might maybe a case of society. So both of you are living at home. You make a decision, right? It's suitable for you and the other person, but maybe it's not suitable for the society, right? So what about the environment? Is the decision fitting also the environment? Let's say at BSV, if you decided to put a heater that does a lot of electricity and all that, maybe it's good for you. It's not maybe good for the environment. You see? So it has to meet these three criteria. That's the first principle. Right? This is very easy. On one side is happiness, on the other side is suffering. Another criteria is motivation. 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 Motivational principle. Principle. Alright. This regarding about what's the motivation behind it? What's the motivation behind your decision? This is so important. So important. From a Buddhist point of view, and I think in general, doesn't matter even if you are not Buddhist, this is so important because we have to look at what was the motivation behind your decision. This is a sutta which is called Sangita Sutta, I find in Digha Nikaya, about agatis, they're called agatis, the four ways of going wrong. These are the four ways of going wrong. Making a decision based on greed, attachment, clinging to views, based on hatred, based on confusion or delusion, and based on fear. You don't want to make decision based on greed, attachment, hatred, confusion, and delusion, all right? And also fear. So that's going wrong if you make decision based on those four things. So you want to make decision based on generosity, and letting go, or non-clinging, in the other words, non-clinging to your views, right? Then based on loving kindness and compassion, right? Decision based on wisdom and understanding. And the fourth, decision based on courage. So that's a way of going right. Any decision you make, it has to be motivated by generosity, contentment, non-clinging, loving kindness, compassion, wisdom and understanding, and courage. My friend, there's no time to tell you. One time I watched a documentary film whereby a pilot made a decision to go back to Amsterdam by KL flight because fuel was going to be very costly at another airport, and also they would cancel his license and he would lose a job. So he decided to refuel the plane at a cheaper airport and decided to refuel the plane so that he doesn't have to put all the passengers in a hotel. And so what he did is to refuel the plane and then took off so that he can actually land in Canary Island and continue on to Amsterdam so that he stays with his license, pilot license. He was a captain and he caused death. 500 people died. I saw that documentary. You can even watch it. It's called The Flight documentary. It's like a crash between Pan Am and KLM. This was a decision, and this was the best captain in Amsterdam. Made a decision based on fear. Fear to lose his license. Well, you must be an enlightened person to make a decision on what I'm saying like this. But even when we are not enlightened, actually we can have a template to work with. Lastly, decisions made, principle is called priority. Priority principle. Okay, priority. This is very, very important in terms of decision making. Again, is given the sutras, Anguttara Nikaya. They are called the three priorities. The three priorities, one is called atta dipateya. Atta dipateya means self-priority, consensus. Right? One's own consensus. Right? So a human being, before you make a decision, there's some kind of inside your mind, something telling you, oh, you shouldn't go to meditate, or you should go and watch a movie, or you should not actually buy a new property, or no, you shouldn't actually marry at this time, you shouldn't get involved in a relationship at this time. So inside you, there is always something going on. This is called atta dipateya, which means priority based on oneself, you yourself. The other one is called loka adipateya, which means decision based on public opinion. Public opinion plays a big opinion, all right? Public opinion, whether it's government or law enforcement, also actually influence the way we make decision. So the decision we are making, is it going to be censored? Is it going to be censored by the wise people? Or it's going to be blamed? Or is it praiseworthy? Right, you might make a decision, but the wise people, even like your advisor, you have advisor, Hajan Brahm, he may censor the decision you have made. So this is very, very important, that though you can make a decision here, but other people may come who are wiser, and then they blame you. Why did you demolish this room? So when you make a decision, it's not only the organization, it's not only home, but also we have to consider about your elders, your in-laws, your peers, many things, especially if they're wise, right? Then third one, this is very, very important. Dhamma dipateya, decision based on a Dhamma, grounded in a Dhamma. Because Dhamma is the way how things are. So decision based on Dhamma. If you make a decision without Dhamma into the equation, Dhamma, the way how things are, true nature of things. So this, friends, is very, very important. While self is very important in terms of a priority principle, and public is very important, but the final measure is in any decision you make, whether it's in sync with Dhamma. In fact, when it comes to the leadership, even respect, the Dhamma is the highly respected principle. Even the Buddha respected Dhamma. That's why when the Buddha was about to pass away or go into stillness, as we say, he said, people ask, who's going to be the leader of the dispensation? Who's going to be? Some people maybe thought it's Ananda or Sariputta. The Buddha said, let the Dhamma Vinaya be my hair. So the Buddha didn't have a successor. The only successor of the Buddha is Dhamma Vinaya. So friends, whenever you make decisions, make sure that it's actually putting Dhamma into account. With that, I reopen this talk. Thank you very much for listening. So if you have questions, come back at 2:30. And because what I'm going to talk about at 2:30 is I'm going to have a slide presentation. Sorry. 12:30. Come here because I'm going to make a presentation on conflict and solution of conflict, because I know making decision bring conflict, the different views bring conflict. So this is actually a continuation, but it's in terms of slideshow. This is a way to keep you around. So anyway, this is going to be 20 slides that I presented on a conference in Burma. So you're going to have fun. And sorry, this is a long talk about decision making and all that. So I'll give you a chance to ask questions at 12:30, because it's the same topic basically. Thank you very much for listening.